Shoe Dog by Phil Knight, a memoir by the creator of Nike. Chapter 1, 1962. When I broached the subject with my father, when I worked up the nerve to speak to him about my crazy idea, I made sure it was in the early evening. That was always the best time with Dad. He was relaxed then, well-fed, stretched down in his vinyl recliner in the TV nook. I can still tilt back my head and close my eyes and hear the sound of the audience laughing. The tinny theme songs of his favorite shows, Wagon Train and Rawhide. His all-time favorite was Red Buttons. Every episode began with Red singing, "Ho ho, hee hee, strange things are happening." I set a straight back chair beside him and gave a wan smile and waited for the next commercial. I'd rehearse my spiel in my head over and over, especially the opening. "So, Dad, you remember that crazy idea I had at Stanford?" It was one of my final classes, a seminar on entrepreneurship. I'd written a research paper about shoes, and the paper had evolved from the run-off-the-mill assignment to an all-out obsession. Being a runner, I knew something about running shoes. Being a business buff, I knew that Japanese cameras had made deep cuts into the camera market, which had once been dominated by Germans. Thus, I argued in my paper that Japanese running shoes might do the same thing. The idea interested me, then inspired me, then captivated me. It seemed so obvious, so simple, so potentially huge. Chapter 2, 1963. My father invited all the neighbors over for coffee and cake and a special viewing of Buck's slides. Dutifully, I stood at the slide projector, savoring the darkness, listlessly clicking the advance button and describing the pyramids, the temple of Nike. But I wasn't there. I was at the pyramids. I was at the temple of Nike. I was wondering about my shoes. 4 months after the big meeting at Onitsuka, after I'd connected with those executives and won them over, or so I thought, and still the shoes hadn't arrived, I fired off a letter. "Dear sirs, re our meeting of last fall, have you had a chance to ship the samples?" Then I took a few days off to sleep, wash my clothes, catch up with friends. I got a speedy reply from Onitsuka. "Shoes coming," the letter said, "in just a little more days." I showed the letter to my father. He winced. "A little more days, Buck?" he said, chuckling. "That $50 is long gone." My new look, castaway hair, caveman beard, was too much for my mother and sisters. I'd catch them staring, frowning. I could hear them thinking, "Bum," so I shaved. Afterward, I stood before the little mirror on my burrow in the servants' quarters and told myself, "It's official. You're back." Chapter 3, 1964. The notice arrived right around Christmas, so I must have driven down to the waterfront warehouse the first week of 1964. I don't recall exactly. I know it was early morning. I can see myself getting there before the clerks unlocked the doors. I handed them the notice, and they went into the back and returned with a large box covered in Japanese writing. I raced home, scurried down to the basement, ripped open the box. 12 pairs of shoes, creamy white, with blue stripes down the sides. God, they were beautiful. They were more than beautiful. I'd seen nothing in Florence or Paris that surpassed them. I wanted to put them on marble pedestals or in gilt-edged frames. I held them up to the light, caressed them as sacred objects, the way a writer might treat a new set of notebooks, or a baseball player a rack of bats. Then I sent 2 pairs to my old track coach at Oregon, Bill Bowerman. I did so without a second thought, since it was Bowerman who'd first made me think, really think, about what people put on their feet. Bowerman was a genius coach, a master motivator, a natural leader of young men, and there was one piece of gear he deemed crucial to their development, shoes. He was obsessed with how human beings are shod. Chapter 4, 1965. I got a letter from that Jeff Johnson fellow at the start of the year. After our chance meeting at Occidental, I sent him a pair of Tigers as a gift, and now he wrote to say that he tried them on and gone for a run. He liked them, he said. He liked them a whole lot. Others liked them too. People kept stopping him and pointing at his feet and asking where they could buy some neat shoes like those. Johnson had gotten married since I last saw him, he said, and there was already a baby on the way, so he was looking for ways to earn extra cash. apart from his gig as a social worker, and this tiger's shoe seemed to have more upside than Adidas. I wrote him back and offered him a post as a commissioned salesman, meaning I'd give him $1.75 for each pair of running shoes he sold, $2 for each pair of spikes. I was just beginning to put together a crew of part-time sales reps, and that was the standard rate I was offering. He wrote back right away, accepting the offer. And then the letters didn't stop. On the contrary, they increased in length and number. At first, there were 2 pages, then 4, then 8. At first, they came every few days. Then they came faster and faster, tumbling almost daily through the mail slot like a waterfall, each one with that same return address. P.O. Box 492, Seal Beach, California, 90740. Until I wondered what in God's name I'd done in hiring this guy. Chapter 5, 1966. As I neared the end of my contract with Onitsuka, I checked the mail every day hoping for a letter that would say they wanted to renew, or that they didn't. There would be relief in knowing either way. Of course, I was hoping for a letter from Sarah saying she'd change her mind, and as always, I was braced for a letter from my bank telling my business was no longer welcome. But every day, the only letters were from Johnson. Like Bowerman, the man didn't sleep, ever. I could think of no other explanation of his ceaseless stream of correspondence, much of which was pointless. Along with gobs of information I didn't need, the typical Johnson letter would include several long parenthetical asides and some kind of rambling joke. There might also be a hand-drawn illustration. There might also be a musical lyric. Sometimes there was a poem. Based out on a manual typewriter that violently brailled the onion-skinned pages, many Johnson letters contain some kind of story, maybe parable is a better word, how Johnson has sold this person a pair of tigers, but down the road said person might be good for X more pairs, and therefore Johnson had a plan. How Johnson had chased and badgered the head coach at such and such high school and tried to sell him 6 pairs, but in the end sold him a baker's dozen, which just went to show. Chapter 6, 1967. I didn't handle it well, not well at all, knowing what his reaction would be and dreading it. I put off telling Johnson the whole story. I shot him a quick note saying the meeting with Onitsuka had gone fine, telling him I'd secure national distribution rights, but I left it at that. I think I must have held out hope in the back of my mind that I might be able to hire someone else to go east, or that Wallace would blow the whole plan up. And in fact, I did hire someone else, a former distance runner, of course, but he changed his mind, backed out just days after agreeing to go. So frustrated, distracted, mired in a cycle of anxiety and procrastination, I turned to the much simpler problem of finding someone to replace Johnson at the store in Santa Monica. I asked John Bort, a high school track coach in Los Angeles, a friend of a friend. He jumped at the chance. He couldn't have been more eager. How could I have known he'd be quite so eager? The next morning, he appeared at Johnson's store and announced that he was the new boss. The new what? Johnson said. Chapter 7, 1968. I was putting in 6 days a week at Price Waterhouse, spending early mornings and late nights and all weekends and vacations at Blue Ribbon. No friends, no exercise, no social life, and wholly content. My life was out of balance, sure, but I didn't care. In fact, I wanted even more imbalance, or a different kind of imbalance. I wanted to dedicate every minute of every day to Blue Ribbon. I'd never been a multitasker, and I didn't see any reason to start now. I wanted to be present, always. I wanted to focus constantly on the one task that really mattered. If my life was to be all hard work and no play, I wanted my work to be play. I wanted to quit Pricewaterhouse, not that I hated it, it just wasn't me. I wanted what everyone wants. To be me, full-time. But it wasn't possible. Blue Ribbon simply couldn't support me. Though the company was on track to double sales for a 5th straight year, it still couldn't justify a salary for its co-founder. So I decided to compromise, find a different day job, one that would pay my bills but require fewer hours, leaving me more time for my passion. Chapter 8, 1969. Suddenly, a whole new cast of characters was wandering in and out of the office. Rising sales enabled me to hire more and more reps. Most were ex-runners and eccentrics, as only ex-runners can be. But when it came to selling, they were all business. because they were inspired by what we were trying to do, and because they worked solely on commission, $2 a pair. They were burning up the roads, hitting every high school and college track meet with a 1,000-mile radius, and their extraordinary effort for boosting our numbers even more. We posted 150,000 in sales in 1968, and in 1969, we were on our way to just under $300,000. Though Wallace was still breathing down my neck, hassling me to slow down and moaning about my lack of equity, I decided that Blue Ribbon was doing well enough to justify a salary for its founder. Right before my 31st birthday, I made the bold move. I quit Portland State and went full-time at my company, paying myself a fairly generous $18,000 a year. Above all, I told myself the best reason for leaving Portland State was that I had already got more out of the school, penny, than I'd ever hoped. I got something else too, I just didn't know it at the time, nor did I dream how valuable it would prove to be. Chapter 9, 1970. I had to fly to Japan again, and this time 2 weeks before Christmas. I didn't like leaving Penny alone with Matthew, especially around the holidays, but it couldn't be avoided. I needed to sign a new deal with Onitsuka, or not. Kid in me was keeping me in suspense. He wouldn't tell me his thoughts about renewing me until I arrived. Yet again, I found myself at a conference table surrounded by Onitsuka executives. This time, Mr. Onitsuka didn't make his trademark late entrance, nor did he absent himself pointedly. He was there from the start, presiding. He opened the meeting by saying that he intended to renew Blue Ribbon for another 3 years. I smiled for the first time in weeks. Then I pressed my advantage. I asked for a longer deal. Yes, 1973 seemed light years away, but it would be here in a blink. I needed more time and security. My bankers needed more. 5 years? I said. Chapter 10, 1971. Guess who's coming to dinner? Woodell said. He wheeled into my office and handed me the telex. Kid and me had accepted my invitation. He was coming to Portland to spend a few days. Then he was going to make a wider tour of the United States for reasons he declined to share. Visiting other potential distributors, I said to Woodell. He nodded. It was March 1971. We vowed that Kid and me was going to have the time of his life, that he would return home feeling love in his heart for America, Oregon, Blue Ribbon, and me. When we were done with him, he'd be incapable of doing business with anyone else, and so we agreed the visit should close on a high note with a gala dinner at the home of our prized asset, Bowerman. In mounting this charm offensive, naturally, I enlisted Penny. Together, we met Kinemi's flight, and together we whisked him straight to the Oregon coast, to her parents' oceanfront cottage, where we'd spent our wedding night. Kinemi had a companion with him, a sort of bag carrier, personal assistant, amanuensis named Hiraku Iwano. He was just a kid, naive, innocent, in his early 20s, and Penny had him eating out of her hand before we hit Sunset Highway. Chapter 11, 1972. Everything depended on Chicago. Our every thought, our every conversation at the start of 1972 began and ended with Chicago. Because Chicago was the site of the National Sporting Goods Association show. Chicago was important every year. The Sporting Goods show was where sales reps from across the nation got their first look at all the new athletic products from all the different companies and voted up or down via the sizes of their orders. But this 1972 show was going to be more than important. It was going to be our Super Bowl and our Olympics and our Bar Mitzvah, because it was where we decided to introduce the world to Nike. If sales reps liked our new shoe, we'd live to see another year. If not, we wouldn't be back for the 1973 show. Onitsuka, meanwhile, was eyeing Chicago too. Days before the start of the show, without a word to me, Onitsuka gave the Japanese press an announcement trumpeting their acquisition of Blue Ribbon. The announcement set off shockwaves everywhere, but especially at Nisho Sumeragi Robi, asking, in essence, what the? Chapter 12, 1973. Like his coach, Pri just wasn't himself after the 1972 Olympics. He was haunted and enraged by the terrorist attacks, and by his performance, he felt he let everyone down. He'd finished fourth. no shame in being the world's fourth best at your distance, we told him. But Pre knew he was better than that. And he knew he'd have done better if he hadn't been so stubborn. He showed no patience, no guile. He could have slipped behind the front runner, coasted in his wake, stolen silver. That, however, would have gone against Pre's religion. So he'd run all out, as always, holding nothing back. And in the final 100 yards, he tired. Worse, the man he considered his arch rival, Lassi Virin of Finland, once more took the gold. We tried to lift Pre's spirits. We assured him that Oregon still loved him. City officials in Eugene were even planning to name a street after him. Great, Pre said. What are they going to call it? Fourth Street? He locked himself in his metal trailer on the banks of the Willamette and he didn't come out for weeks. In time, after pacing a lot, after playing with his German Shepherd puppy, Lobo, and after large quantities of cold beer, Pre emerged. One day, I heard that he'd been seen again around town at dawn, doing his daily 10 miles, Lobo trotting at his heels. Chapter 13, 1974. I sat in the federal courthouse in downtown Portland, a little wooden table alongside Strasser and Cousin Hauser, staring at the high ceiling. I tried to take deep breaths. I tried not to look to my left at the opposing table, at the 5 Raptor Eye lawyers representing Onitsuka and 4 other distributors, all of whom wanted to see me ruined. It was April 14, 1974. We tried one last time to avoid this nightmare. In the moments before the trial began, we offered to settle. We told Onitsuka, pay us $800,000 in damages. Withdraw your suit in Japan. We'll withdraw ours and we'll all walk away. I didn't think there was much chance of acceptance, but Cousin Hauser thought it was worth the try. Onitsuka rejected the offer instantly and made no counter. They were out for blood. Now the bailiff shouted, "Court is in session." The judge swooped into the courtroom and banged his gavel, and my heart jumped. This is it, I told myself. Chapter 14. Early in 1975. Pay Nisho first. This was my morning chant, my nightly prayer, my number one priority. And it was my daily instruction to the man who played the Sundance Kid to my Butch Cassidy, Hayes. Before paying back the bank, I said, before paying back anyone, pay Nisho. It wasn't so much a strategy as a necessity. Nisho was like equity. Our line of credit at the bank was $1 million, but we had another million in credit with Nisho, which willingly took second position, which made the bank feel more secure. All of this would unspool, however, if Nisho weren't there. Ergo, we needed to keep Nisho happy. Always, always pay Nisho first. It wasn't easy, however, this paying Nisho first. It wasn't easy paying anyone. We were undergoing an explosion in assets and inventory, which put enormous strains on our cash reserves. With any growth company, this is the typical problem. But we were growing faster than the typical growth company. Faster than any growth company I knew of. Our problems were unprecedented, or so it seemed. I was also partly to blame, of course. I refused to even consider ordering less inventory. Grow or die, that's what I believed, no matter the situation. Why cut your orders from 3 million down to 2 million if you believed in your bones that the demand out there was for 5 million? So I was forever pushing my conservative bankers to the brink, forcing them into a game of chicken. I'd order a number of shoes that seemed to them absurd, a number we need to stretch to pay for, and I'd always just barely pay for them in the nick of time, and then just barely pay our other monthly bills at the last minute, always doing just enough and no more to prevent the bankers from booting us. And then, at the end of the month, I'd empty our accounts to pay Nisho and start from zero again. Chapter 15. Later in 1975. There was no victory party. There was no victory dance. There wasn't even a quick victory jig in the halls. There wasn't time. We still didn't have a bank, and every company needs a bank. Hayes made a list of banks with the most deposits in Oregon. They were all much smaller than First National or Bank of California, but oh well, beggars, choosers, etc. The first 6 hung up on us. Number 7, First State Bank of Oregon, didn't. The bank was in Milwaukee, a little town half an hour up the road from Beaverton. Come on over, said the bank president when I finally got him on the phone. He promised me $1 million in credit, which was about his bank's limit. We moved our account that day. That night, for the first time in about 2 weeks, I put my head on a pillow and slept. The next morning, I lingered with Penny over breakfast and we talked about the upcoming Memorial Day weekend. I told her I didn't know when I crave a holiday so much. I needed rest and sleep and good food. Chapter 16, 1976. Now that we'd gotten past our bank crisis, now that I was reasonably sure of not going to jail, I could go back to asking the deep questions. What are we trying to build here? What kind of company do we want to be? Like most companies, we had role models. Sony, for instance. Sony was the Apple of its day. Profitable, innovative, efficient, and it treated its workers well. When pressed, I often said I wanted to be like Sony. At root, however, I still aimed and hoped for something bigger and vaguer. I would search my mind and heart, and the only thing I could come up with was this word, winning. It wasn't much, but it was far, far better than the alternative. Whatever happened, I just didn't want to lose. Losing was death. Blue Ribbon was my third child, my business child, as Sumeragi said, and I simply couldn't bear the ideal of it dying. It has to live, I told myself. It just has to. That's all I know. Several times in those first months of 1976, I huddled with Hayes and Woodell and Strasser, and over sandwiches and sodas, we'd kick around this question of ultimate goals, this question of winning and losing. Money wasn't our aim, we agreed. Money wasn't our end game. But whatever our aim or end, money was the only means to get there. More money than we had on hand. Chapter 17, 1977. His name was M. Frank Rudy. He was a former aerospace engineer, and he was a true original. One look at him told you he was a nutty professor, though it wasn't until years later that I learned the full extent of his nuttiness. He had a business partner, Bob Boger, another brainiac, and they had a crazy idea, and together they're going to pitch us. That's the sum total of what I knew that morning in March 1977, as we settled around the conference table. I wasn't even sure how these guys reached us or how they'd arranged this meeting. Okay, fellas, I said, what have you got? It was a beautiful day, I remember. The light outside the room was a buttery pale yellow, and the sky was blue for the first time in months. So I was distracted, a little spring feverish, as Rudy leaned his weight on the edge of the conference table and smiled. Mr. Knight, we've come up with a way to inject air into a running shoe. I frowned and dropped my pencil. Why? I said. For greater cushioning, he said. For greater support for the ride of a lifetime. Chapter 18, 1978. Strasser was our five-star general, and I was ready to follow him into any fray. In our fight with Onitsuka, his outrage had comforted and sustained me, and his mind had been a formidable weapon. In this new fight with the feds, he was doubly outraged. Good, I thought. He stomped around the offices like a pissed off Viking, and his stomps were music to my ears. We both knew, however, that rage wasn't going to be enough, nor was Strasser alone. We were taking on the United States of America. We needed a few good men. So Strasser reached out to a young Portland lawyer, a friend of his named Richard Werschel. I don't remember ever being introduced to Werschel. I don't remember anyone asking me to meet him or hire him. I just remember suddenly being aware of Werschel, extremely conscious of his presence all the time. The way you're aware of a big woodpecker in your front yard or on your head. For the most part, Werschel's presence was welcome. He had the kind of the go-go motor we liked, and the credentials we always looked for. Stanford undergrad, University of Oregon law. He also had a compelling personality, a presence, dark, wiry, sarcastic, bespectacled. He possessed an uncommonly deep, plummy baritone, like Darth Vader with a head cold. Overall, he gave the impression of a man with a plan, and the plan didn't include surrender or sleep. Chapter 19. 1979. He occupied a teeny office at the Treasury Department, a space about the size of my mother's linen closet. There was barely room for his government-issued gunmetal gray desk, let alone the matching chair for infrequent visitors. He pointed to his chair. "Sit," he said. I sat. I looked around in disbelief. This was the home base of the man who kept sending us those bills for $25 million? I looked now at him, this beady-eyed bureaucrat. What creature did he remind me of? Not a worm? No, he was bigger than that. Not a snake? He was less simple than that. Then I had it. Johnson's pet octopus. I recalled Stretch dragging the helpless crab back to its lair. Yes, this bureaucrat was a kraken. A micro-kraken. A burrow kraken. Smothering these thoughts, burying all my hostility and fear, I screwed a fake smile onto my face and tried it in a friendly tone to explain that this whole thing was a gigantic misunderstanding. Even the Bureau Crockin's colleagues within the Treasury Department sided with our position. I handed him a document. You have right here, I said, a memo stating that the American selling price does not apply to Nike shoes. The memo comes from Treasury. Not binding? I gritted my teeth. But this whole case, I said, is nothing but the result of a dirty trick played by our competitors. We're being penalized for our success. Chapter 20, 1980. We all gathered in the conference room and Chan gave us his bio. He was born in Shanghai and raised in opulence. His grandfather was the third largest soy sauce manufacturer in northern China, and his father had been the third highest ranking member of the Chinese Ministry of Foreign Affairs. When Chang was a teenager, however, the revolution came. The Changs fled to the United States, to Los Angeles, where Chang attended Hollywood High. He often thought he'd go back, and his parents did also. They kept in close touch with friends and family in China, and his mother remained extremely close with Sun Qingling, the godmother of the revolution. In the meantime, Chang attended Princeton and studied architecture and moved to New York. He landed a job at a good architectural firm, where he worked on the Levittown project. Then he set up his own firm. He was making decent money, doing good work, but bored stiff. He wasn't having any fun, and he didn't feel he was accomplishing anything real. One day, a Princeton friend complained about being unable to get a visa for Shanghai. Chang helped his friend get the visa and helped him set up appointments with business contacts and found that he enjoyed it. Being an emissary, a go-between was a better use of his time and talents. Thank you for listening.